Surrey, and I felt myself backsliding. I was starting to engage in some things I knew that was not pleasing to the Lord, and so I begged my mom and dad if they would allow me to move out here until they came later in the spring. And so on January 31st, 1976, we boarded a plane and flew, and they had to wait the night in Spokane because of the fog, and we took a flight and ended up having to ride the bus from Boise to Spokane. They picked me up and we got in here right before Sunday school, February 1st, 1976. And right about here where the pulpit stood, Brother Cockrell delivered a message, and he preached about the withered branch. And I could not wait until he finally gave the invitation, and I came to the altar and weeping and crying because I was that withered branch. And well, I had so many significant spiritual happenings in this house that formed me and shaped me, and I'll forever be grateful. And they opened their home to me, they rescued me, and they were literally a model. I had not planned this, but he brought it up, and it fits this message today. And they modeled really what I want to deliver to you today, and I'll get to that in a moment, but we're going to play one of my favorite songs. I'm not going to sing. I thought I'd get a hallelujah out of that one. Here you go. Listen to the lyrics to this great old song.
There's a lighthouse on the hillside that overlooks life's sea. When I'm tossed, it seems a light that I might see, and the light that shines in darkness now will safely lead the soul if it wasn't for the lighthouse. My ship will be no more. Everybody that lives around us says tear that lighthouse down. The big ships, they don't sail by this way anymore. Ain't no use in standing around. Then my mind goes back to that stormy night. Just in time, I seen the light, yes, the light from that old lighthouse that stands up there on the hill.
His life in 1783 to 1826. And the first line of this old hymn, it's actually a Christmas carol, and it says, "Brightest and best of the sons of the morning, dawn on our darkness and lend us thine aid. You can tell how old it is by the phraseology. Dawn on our darkness and lend us thine aid. In John 18, Jesus spake again unto them, saying, I am the light of the world. He that followeth me shall not walk in darkness, but shall have the light of life. And there's the key. You want to walk in light, you got to follow him. He's the light of the world. And throughout different junctures of my life, I chose to follow him, and he brought light to me. And it dispelled the darkness in my life. And so I know I'm talking to somebody today. I don't know who. God hasn't revealed that to me, but he laid this on my heart. Someone needs to hear this message today. Jesus is the light of the world. He's the way, the truth, and life. No other way can you get to the Father but through him. And he will dispel all of your darkness. You're going to look at that, and I'm not going to try to define what your darkness is, but he's the light of the world. And he's there for us, but we've got to engage. We have to initiate our faith. We become believers, and we follow him, and we walk after him. We can't do it our own way, our own ideas, and our own thoughts. We have to pursue after him. For the love of the Lord our God with what? All of our heart, all of our soul, all of our strength. So many times we try to want to rewrite the book and rewrite the rules and the regulations, or sometimes we just see it as that, rather than seeing it as an invitation to know him and to follow him. Man, when you get connected with God, it's not like I'm being browbeaten, I have to. It's I get to, and I want to, and I love to. Jesus is the light of the world. John 9:5, he says, as long as I'm in the world, I am the light of the world. And John 12:46, I am come a light in the world, that whosoever believeth on me should not abide in darkness. He's the light, and his will is that I wouldn't abide in darkness. So we played this song, and I only want to repeat a portion of it. That second verse says, everyone that lives around us says, tear that old lighthouse down. The big ships don't sail this way anymore. There ain't no use in standing around. There's a lot of people in our world today, whether it's a billionaire or if it's a politician or whoever, they're saying it's irrelevant. It's not useful. It's not good anymore. What good is it anymore? You're following something that has brought bondage, and they just tried to rewrite the story, and they don't know this king. And they say, tear this lighthouse down. But then my mind goes back to that stormy night when just in time I saw the light. When the light from that old lighthouse that stands there on a hill, I thank God for the lighthouse. So let's look at this darkness. We've all had it. We all battle with it from time to time. Darkness. When you say, no, I'm a Christian, I'm walking in the light. Yes, but I still have a battle. You know, there's a scripture that says, be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, is a roaring lion, walketh about, seeking whom he may devour. I have an enemy, and he does attack. How many's been attacked by the enemy before? In your mind, in your thoughts. And you think about all of these things. So what does darkness look like? What does it look like in our life? Sometimes it can be depression. It can be discouragement. We feel beat down and browbeat, or we feel like the world is against. We feel like sometimes I expected this was going to happen. Here it is. I just knew it was going to happen. It was too good to be true. And we get these things happen, and it can bring discouragement and anguish to us. It can be grief. It can be sorrow. It can be sorrow that I'm not getting to keep the things that I once had. You know, as a child, I grew up, and all the things that I seemed to love, I lost. And I really developed in me a fear that I'm going to lose the thing that I love the most. Every dog I got or had that I loved got run over on the highway. Highway 97 took many of my dreams as a kid growing up. And so I began to have this fear work in me. And when Teresa and I married right here in this church, May 23rd, 1980, I had the fear that I would lose her, because everything that I loved, Dad died when I was only 19. The things that I loved, I would lose that. And I had this ideology that something is just around the corner, so that's going to happen, and I'm going to lose the thing that I love. So when that fire whistle blew here in Oroville, I would panic. Nobody knew it. I didn't tell anyone, but I would have pretty much a panic attack in my heart, not knowing, where is Teresa? Is she okay? I'm afraid she's been in an accident. Something bad has happened. And that every time the fire whistle blew, I was in a panic until I found, and this is pre-cell phone days, and so you're on your job, you don't know how she is and all of that. I'm telling you, there's darkness in many different forms, and it can creep into your life and affect you. It can be discouragement, regret. Have I reached the goals in life? Am I where I thought I ought to be, or what? How is it going in my life? It can be broken dreams. Darkness can be broken dreams. I dreamed of having this, but look at this. I dreamed of doing that, but here I am. It can be a darkness that can just overwhelm us. It can be loneliness. You know, you can be in a crowd of people and be lonely.
Yes.
And nobody knows. You're just kind of in your shell. It's darkness. It's darkness. Condemnation, bitterness, anger, rage, hatred, fear, anxiety, revenge, jealousy, covetousness, selfishness. The list goes on and on and on. What is your darkness? I've got things that has affected me that doesn't affect you. You have things that affect you that doesn't affect me. It doesn't not gauge as to who's darker or who has more darkness. And darkness is darkness. Many years ago, I was at a concert. It was a Dallas Home concert down in Lewiston. And I was having a rough time. It's 1995, and that was a rough year for us in the pastorate in Hayden. I was having issues with people. They're having issues with me. And it was not a fun rodeo. That's to say the least. It was a rodeo. It was not fun. And I felt all of this darkness. And I felt really alone and all these pieces in my life. And I ended up at this concert. And on stage was Dallas Holmes' wife singing. And she paused and she gave her testimony. And I'm here needing some encouragement, you know. And then she starts talking about the darkness that she faced that year. Cancer and cancer treatment and surgery. And all the more she talked, the further I slumped in my chair. And I'm thinking, wow, I'm complaining about what's going on in my life, and you're battling cancer. And I slumped further and further, my head down. And then she said this. She said, darkness is darkness. She said, my darkness is cancer. Your darkness is whatever it is. It has the same effect on our soul. Darkness is darkness. And I felt the light begin to come into my soul. And God was penetrating the darkness. I want to give you a couple of testimonies. I don't know how far I'll get, but I want to give you a couple of testimonies. One of them was in 1986. Log this in your mind. And I want to talk about first, before I give you this testimony of a darkness that Teresa and I faced, I want to talk to you quickly about this marvelous light. This light. Jesus is the light of the world. Now, I don't pretend to be a scientist. I'm not. And I'm not going to pretend, but I've listened to some pretty good men that are very knowledgeable in these things. So I'm going to echo what they say. So you just have to trust me. I know that's hard, but you just have to trust me. How many like a lightning storm? As long as you're not in danger. I love thunder and lightning. Boom. Now my Schnauzer doesn't really love it so much, but Teresa and I, we like it. We're like sitting in a safe place and watching a big thunderstorm with a lightning flash. Well, I just want to look at this thing. Lightning's a pretty powerful thing. You don't think so? Ask your pastor. He's been kind of struck by lightning. It blew him off of a freezer on a porch in Missouri and nearly killed him. Maybe twice you were in a tree, or you got two different times. Yeah, so he knows a little bit of the power of lightning. Well, lightning takes a magnetic charge from the heavens up in the clouds and a small magnetic charge from the earth. they understand the mechanics of lightning. The people that study this, the scientists, they can tell you, they know how it works. There's a small magnetic and a magnetic charge, and they meet, and there's this huge explosion, and it creates this lightning bolt, and there is a flash of light. Here's the problem. They know how it works, but where does the light come from? That's what they're just, and so the only way they can describe it is, how many know we have this realm that we live in, and that there's just across the veil, there is another realm where God is. And he fills all of the expanse that is never ending. He created the heavens and the earth. And so we know that just beyond this veil, on the other side is where he is. And so they know that there's this lightning, this magnetic charges, and then there's this explosion. It's like as though there's a rupture. They describe it this way, like a rupture of this realm. It's like the atom and the atom bomb and all of that. And then there's a rupture and it comes back. And that is the explosion. That is the boom. They know how it works, but they don't know where does this flash of light come from. Would you think about that just for a minute? Because it is a scientific fact. Lightning strikes the earth every single second somewhere on this planet. Since I've been preaching, it's been every second, counting 1001, 1002, 1003. Lightning is striking somewhere on the planet every single second. There is this flash, this rupture, and this release of light that comes in from another place. And they don't know where that is, but there's a rupture, and there's a flash, a release of light, and then it closes back up. There's a gap, and it closes. It's pretty interesting, isn't it? I love it because in Luke 10, verse 18, Jesus said to them there that day, he said, I beheld Satan as lightning fall from heaven. I beheld Satan as lightning fall from heaven. Lightning's the release of light. Jesus, the light of the world, the release of light every single second. I love this idea because it's as though God is giving a reminder to you and I and his adversary. I saw you fall from heaven. You have been stripped of everything that you are. You are the adversary. You're forever, eternally doomed. And I'm going to remind you every single moment, every single second, that I am the light of the world. You're not king. I'm king. I am the light. So what does that say to you and I? He is the light of the world. He comes into our world. He dispels. He has the power to remove all darkness, whatever your darkness is. Is sometimes we think, I don't know if God's big enough for that. I don't know if he can deliver me from this darkness. And we have these worries, do we not? Am I talking to anybody here today? You have a darkness, and I don't know if I can ever overcome this. I don't know if I will ever get beyond that. I don't know if I'm ever fully equipped for this that will come in my life. And we can be, even become fearful of the darkness. But Jesus said, I am the light of the world. And I saw Satan fall as lightning. And lightning strikes every single moment on the earth. There's this release of light, God's light, into our realm that will dispel the darkness. Are you with me this morning? All right. Now go with me on a little story. 1986, I was in the district youth department, and back up just a little bit. When I was a little boy, throwing a baseball, my arm always hurt. And I thought everyone's arm hurt when you threw a ball, because mine did. Every single time you pick up and throw anything, my arm hurt. Well, that just got progressively worse and worse and worse. Went to the doctor here in town, and the local doctor here says, well, you have it's called painful arc syndrome. Well, whatever that is, it still hurts. And a cream didn't fix it. And further down the line, I ended up going to a specialist in Yakima. And he says, let's take an x-ray. He says, you still got something going on there. Let's take another test called a tomogram. And he took that and he said, I need you to come in and get the results of this tomogram. And so I come in. Now thinking, all I had was a torn muscle. A pulled muscle. That's what I thought. That's Teresa thought it, I thought it, so I'm gonna go to the doctor. He's gonna say we're gonna do some therapy or we'll do this or that. And he goes, I walk into the doctor's office and he says, well, you got something going on in your arm. It's called a tumor. And you have a tumor in your humerus and it's grown out of the bone into your shoulder. We're gonna operate on you and we're going to pull it out, remove it, and do a bone graft. And if that works, fine, we'll test it, see if it's benign or cancerous. And if that works, fine. If not, you'll have to go cancer treatment. This is 1986. Alvin was dying of cancer at that time. I stood right here on this platform. I was his best man at his wedding. Missy had cancer at that time. I'm just thinking, they got cancer. And what did I think at that moment? I got cancer. He said, if that surgery doesn't work, we're going to do it again and we'll replace your shoulder. If that doesn't work, we're going to amputate your right arm to save your life. And you're going to have to undergo cancer treatment. I thought I had a pulled muscle. I left the doctor's office stunned. People are dying of cancer, having cancer surgeries. And I didn't see the possibility of having, I just like, I have cancer and I'm going to die. For the next 2 hours, I drove the streets of Yakima. Takes 5 minutes to get home from the doctor's office to where I live on 202 North 8th Street in Yakima. And I drove for 2 hours, dazed, just stunned, driving the streets. I have cancer. I'm going to die. That's what I thought. When I got home, I broke the news to Teresa. It's a true story. We sat on the front porch of that parsonage in Yakima from about 6 p.m. that night. We sat all night long. She held my head and we didn't speak a word. We watched the sun come up the next morning. We were two very terrified kids. That was my darkness. I'm here to tell you, darkness can look like that. Darkness can look like when you're in your 60s and your children report to you and tell you we're moving away and taking your grandchildren and moving across the state. I'm telling you, that was a real dark period and moment in my life last year. Having to tuck my little 8-year-old grandson in a bed in my house, and he reaches up and kisses me and lays back down in tears forming in his eyes. He just said, Grandpa, I just don't want to leave you. It was heartbreaking. It was darkness. And I'll tell you, but just in time, I saw the light. The light shined into my darkness. The light of the world. How do I get that light? I don't like this darkness. I don't know about you, I've been in a lot of darkness. I know what it's like. I used to hunt all the time by myself. Teresa didn't like it, but I enjoyed it and I liked to hunt. Where I hunted, nobody else hunted. I drove as far as I could, I rode my motorcycle as far as I could, and then I hiked further with just my bow and my .44. I'm elk hunting and I love doing that. And I enjoyed that. And I remember many times Claude walking into either my tree stand or wanting to get back into this bowl where some bulls are bugling, and I would walk in 2 hours before daylight and I had to coach my way in all the way. There's not a bear behind that bush. There's not a bear behind that bush. There's not a bear behind that bush. There's not a cougar over there. There's not a cougar over there. Because every sound that you hear, you're thinking there is peril right there behind that. And so I had to coach my way all the way in because I'm not that fond of darkness. Are you afraid of the dark? Yeah, a little bit. Things out there I can't see, right? Darkness, none of us like darkness. So how do I get out of the darkness? We know it's our faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. But how does that light keep coming to me? It's simply a love through His Word. Yes. A love for His Word. David said, Thy word have I hid in my heart that I may not sin against Thee, O God. His living Word. He is the way, the truth, the life. We hide His Word in our heart. It's the engrafted Word that is able to save our souls. It's enjoying His Word. It's reading His Word. It's ingesting His Word. He is the living Word. And His Word, we adhere to that. We absorb, we take it into us. And it's like the light comes in and it just pushes out. It dispels all the darkness. That has happened over and over. And as hard as a trial it was this last year, when my kids moving away, I told Nathan and Chris, you want to move, that's fine. Leave the grandkids here. Well, that don't work, but and little Dominic, he was up for that one. Or so I never even suggested it. In fact, the last 2 weeks ago, we were there at their house, and he says, Grandpa, can I go home with you? I said, no, buddy, this is home right here. But you can come see us, and we're going to come see you every single chance. So they've lived over there for about 9 months now, and I've been there 8 months out of nine. And the other one, they came to my house. So I see them once a month, and make a travel, and get to see them. But for me, that was darkness. In fact, to be very honest with you, it's still a little bit dark. I miss them like crazy. I love my grandkids. I really miss them. So how do you exist with this darkness or in this darkness? It's getting His Word inside of you, and it begins to work something mighty and marvelous and wonderful, and it dispels the darkness. And you can begin to see something on the other side. You begin to live again. What was that? We read it earlier. I am come a light into the world. Whosoever believeth on me should not abide in darkness. There's one I just wanted to get. I am the light of the world. He that follows me shall not walk in darkness. He shall have the light of life. I don't want to exist in this realm. I want to live. I don't want to remain in my darkness of fear, discouragement, or depression, or anger. I had to work through some anger over this situation, my kids moving. All kinds of emotions. I don't want to live in that. That's death warmed over. I want the life of God. And as I take His Word and receive it to myself, it's the release of light. And now I begin to live. I have hope. Rather than seeing despair, I have a hope that something positive is going to happen to my grandchildren over in Auburn, Washington, who has one of the worst school systems, has one of the, I've read about it, I'm not trying to judge him, but it's not a pleasant place to be. But I'm telling you, it is a work of God, and I can accept that, and I have a hope that God is getting my grandchildren in a place over there to do something that couldn't happen otherwise. And I accept that, and I celebrate it, and because of it, now I'm living instead of dying. Yeah, it puts me out a little bit of dough, a little bit of time, a little bit of effort, but it's worth every cent. And most of all, having the reassurance that light is being released into my world and dispelling and pushing back all the darkness. Can bad things happen in Auburn, Washington? Yeah, it also can happen in Post Falls, Idaho. What I want to be is in the very center of God's will and the light of the world being released to me. So, I have 5 minutes to wrap this up. Say glory, hallelujah. We're going to skip a couple of stories. I have hundreds of stories in my own life, how darkness came. Jesus, the light of the world. You can read it for yourself. I think I'm preaching to the choir today. But Jesus, with His disciples, He was with them on the stormy sea of Galilee. It was dark. In fact, Scripture even says it was dark. They thought they were going to die. Jesus was even in the boat with them one time. And they rouse Him because they think they're going to die. They're taking on water. They think they're all going to perish. And Jesus just simply speaks and says, peace, be still. Whatever your darkness is, and you know what it is, it can be fear of dying. I know that darkness. There was a time in my life where I was terrified of dying. I'm not terrified of dying now. And I work with people that die every day. I have a patient that is imminent and is actively dying right now. She makes it. I'll see her in the morning. But there was a time when I was terrified of death and terrified of dying. You may have a fear of that. That may be a darkness for you. And Jesus comes to you and he will speak. You'll hear. If you'll get into his word, if you'll receive it with meekness, you will hear him speak. And he'll say, peace, peace, be still. Another time, he comes walking on the water when they were in the stormy sea at night. And Jesus said, be of good cheer. It is I. Be not afraid. I want to close with this. Jesus is the light of the world. But then he looked at his disciples and he said, you are the light of the world. Let there be that grace explosion in your life. Let light penetrate you, get absorbed inside of you. Now you shine. You know how we used to sing it. Isn't it that light? I'm going to let it shine. Put it under a bushel, no. I'm going to let it shine. This little light of mine. So I'm telling you, there are some people in your orbit, in your realm, that need to hear you speak to them. Peace. Be still. Many years ago, I watched old Brother Smith and Raymond Washington. His wife of 50 years, they just celebrated their 50th wedding anniversary, and she died from cancer. I was at her funeral. Old Brother Smith, he was a tall man. This tall, skinny man, he's standing up front, had his children around, had all of his grandchildren. They hovered around him. There was Grandma in the casket. They're all up there in front of the church. I'll never forget it. Old Brother Smith, he's hanging on to all of his grandkids. He's holding them. They go, they hover, they squeeze in as close as they could. They big old long arms. He wrapped them around him. And I'll never forget it. He said, it's going to be okay. It's going to be okay. We're going to make it. What was he doing? The light of the world. He was a vessel. And it was flowing through him to his grandchildren. Peace. Be still. God just says, I need a vessel now. Will you be that vessel? I'd like to flow through you this week. It's one of the joys of my life. I get to do it every day with what I do in the ministry God has put me into. And I get to be that vessel. And I can just say, be of good cheer. Don't be afraid. Fear not, nor be dismayed. For it is the Lord thy God that is with thee. We get to do that one that the word of God will just now flow through. It's a channel. And it touches. Rather than pushing and instilling or placing darkness on other people with discouragement or negativity, I can be that vessel. That light flows through and it begins to touch them. One of the greatest joys I have, I do 4 to 6 chapel services a week in these assisted living facilities. People that can't get out, can't go to church. I take church to them and I am their pastor. I got a congregation of about 150 people I serve every single week. I'm their pastor. It's the only pastor they got. And I get to pastor these people. But it's so beautiful when I can't do it. I can't. I'm not that good. I may be good, but I'm not near that good. And to see God move and flow through me and the light being released to them, and their eyes just light up. The countenance on their face, they are lifted up, and there sometimes tears are flowing down their face. It's not because I'm eloquent, it's not because I'm that gifted or talented. I'm just a vessel that the light is flowing through. So here's your challenge, here's your homework. This next week, how can I be a vessel that the light will flow through just naturally? But you don't even have to go look for someone. Just live it. Just walk it and be aware. And as Holy Spirit positions you, you just let it release. That light, it's a flash, and it just, boom, light is released. And it touches that individual. It's one of the funnest things. When I go out every week, I don't know what's going to happen. It's one of the biggest agendas. You know, I'm supposed to have this, a care plan and all of that. And I'll tell you what really happens. I satisfy the government. I do everything I'm supposed to do. But what really happens in my visits, I go and I just wait. If I will just present myself, if I will just wait for it, Holy Spirit always flows through and does the miraculous. And I mean, it's spectacular. And I can't do that. I totally cannot. Neither can you. But the light of the world flowing through you will dispel and push back the darkness. So what does your community begin to look like when your light shines and just pushes the darkness further and further away? Suicides go down, drug dependency goes down, all of those things. Why? Because the church is shining brightly and giving hope. I'm glad the light came into my life. What if I stayed in that darkness a year ago with my kids? Like, wow, life is over. My grandkids are loose. They're going to forget me. I'm nobody. And I just stayed in that darkness. What would it look like? I'd have been a very unpleasant person to be around. But because the light of the world shined into my life, wow, I have hope. I have dreams for my kids, my family. Oh, maybe I would do things a little different, but that's their lives. That's their family. I can't make all those decisions for them. They'll figure it out. And I just want to make the journey with them. And I'll be the light of the world. And so I go over there, I just be grandpa, I just be who I am. And I just let the light flow through me, and boom, and my grandkids are blessed because of it. I'm telling you, your family members will be the first ones that you touch because you just begin to push back any darkness. I know, 4 minutes over, but I'm telling you, that's why I'm here today. I'm nothing special, but the light flow through me. Whether you realize it or not, some darkness has been pushed back from you. I had a little 90-year-old woman pray for me consistently 2 weeks ago on one Sunday. And she didn't stop until I got to her house in Harrison, Idaho. Nothing happened to me. Everything was fine. Why did she pray? Because I have an adversary. Something was up. And this little grandma heard from God, and she prayed for me and pushed the darkness back. She was overjoyed. I walked into her room. She saw me. I was fine. Something bad would have happened. I know it. Had that little grandma not been the conduit that the light flowed through and touched me. Father, I thank you. Help us. Help us see this word, and it dwell richly in us, and it just touch people. Change lives. Thank you, Father. Bless this congregation. Lord, we want to walk in the light as you were in the light. Through that light, it will dispel all darkness. It will bless this congregation. It will bless this community. It will bless our families. May it be so. We humbly ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you so much. I was thrilled when your pastor, when I offered and he said yes, I tell you, I was overjoyed. Because I knew I'd get to preach in my own home church and get to be here with you. But most of all, I really felt there was something that I needed to deliver to somebody. And I don't know who, but you're here today. The darkness has been pressing down on you. And he said, I just want the light to come. And it's going to push the darkness back. And you can walk in that freedom and that life. Amen.